Hey everyone, welcome back to the podcast. The book we're doing this week is Dune by Brian Herbert.
Isn't it Frank?
You're right, it's probably Frank. I think Brian is probably
Brian's his son. Yeah, who did the last three.
Yeah, he did the last three and a bunch of prequels that I read that are all terrible. Because he's just not a very, he's just nowhere near as talented as his father. But with me is my co-host, as you can hear, Maria.
Hey, yeah.
So Maria, in 100 words or less, how would you describe this book?
I'm just going to go with the initial premise. There are two warring houses, the Harkonnens and the Atreides, and there is a planet called Arrakis, also known as Dune, though it is never referred to as Dune throughout the book.
And this is in a neo-feudal future type sci-fi.
It's like we are far into colonizing other planets, so much so that they've had humans living there long enough that are the natives to the planets, that far. Whew. Into the future. And there's the Atreides and the Harkonnens, and they're two royal families. The Atreides live on Caladan, and then the Emperor decides, no, Atreides, you are now going to rule Arrakis, this hostile planet that creates spice, which is the kind of psychedelic drug everybody's addicted to. It's like a performance enhancer. Not sexual performance, but
Well, you don't know.
I don't. I really don't. They don't go into that. Who knows? But anyway, and so it's really important as far as economically to the whole empire. The Harkonnens had been in charge of it for a while, and Duke Atreides knows that taking over this planet is a Harkonnen trap, but he has to do it because the Emperor said it. Duke Atreides, his name is Leto. He has a son named Paul, and they're all going to move to Arrakis now. Paul's mom is a Bene Gesserit woman. The Bene Gesserits are a sisterhood of
witches.
You don't want to use the term witch.
But they're
mind witches. They have incredible powers of observation. They have an almost prescient sense to predict
stuff. That brings us to one of the big things about the series, which is that in this world, they outlawed machines. You cannot make a machine in the likeness of a human mind. So there's no robots.
No AI.
So essentially, they are all hyper intelligent in terms of their mental abilities. That's kind of what's evolved. So they have mentats, which are basically human computers who can just do a massive amount of processing of information. The Bene Gesserit have trained themselves to be able to control people through very subtle voice cues and
using observations about the person's own. So they're really just these heightened observers.
And so the big thing is that Paul is what the Bene Gesserit have. Okay, so the Bene Gesserit have a breeding program that they're trying to create the Kwisatz Haderach, which is a male version of a Bene Gesserit, which is important for some reason that is never super explained.
But not just a male
explained.
Version. The ability, so apparently the female Bene Gesserits can only see one half of the human side, but there is this other half that no woman can look into. But there will be a man, the Kwisatz Haderach, who will be able to look into the female side, the stuff the woman can look into, and the male side, and thus be all powerful.
There's a certain amount of essentialism in the world building that we'll talk about later, which is bugs me a little bit, but also this is a book from the 70s, so it's a little bit understandable. Yeah. And Paul, basically, his mental abilities are incredible. And basically what happens is that he can kind of see the future.
As the book goes on,
Yeah, he gets to be able to see the future, and he sees that he is going to unleash a jihad of the Fremen, who are the natives of Arrakis, who are super good fighters. And then his house is betrayed by the Harkonnens, which isn't really a spoiler. They talk about that from the very beginning. And the book is kind of then about how he integrates with the Fremen. One thing I will say before we start talking about this, because I think it's kind of important to how I'm going to talk about it, is that this is one of the first, I read this when I was 11. My mom read it to me. This is my third or fourth time reading it. And it was such a foundational work in my understanding of sci-fi and literature that I'm not really able to see it dispassionately or notice problems with it. It's kind of like how if you watch Star Wars as a kid, you just take certain things for granted and you like it for being it. Whereas if you read it when you're older, people sometimes have issues with it. They're like, this is dumb. Why is Vader doing this or that? And you're like, it's just how it is. Look, no, the Ewoks don't break the tone of the films. They've always been there. So I have problems with this book and I definitely have issues with it. And we'll get into those. But I love this book and I don't think I'm really able to view it dispassionately, which is actually why I was really interested in having Maria read it and get her viewpoint. And she finished it about 3 minutes ago because she couldn't get through the ending exactly. So Maria, why don't you tell us where you are with the first, let's go with the, first third. The book is broken up into three thirds, right? Let's start with the first third. What did you think of the first third?
So the first third, I loved the potential of the first third. I was most initially of the three thirds, as it goes, I was most initially interested in the first third, only to be incredibly disappointed. The first third takes place over like a week. Like, I'm talking a couple of days. And so you don't really get a chance to really bond with it, because it's setting up almost Game of Thrones in space, which I was here for. There's all this intrigue. The Harkonnens are laying a trap. That's the word. A trap. They're laying a trap. The Atreides knows there's a trap. The Emperor is off in the background. We don't really meet him yet. But anyway, and on top of like knowing that there's this trap happening, the Atreides, especially Duke Leto, who I liked, but never got a chance to love. He's trying to do better for this world. The Harkonnens have done a real shit job. They haven't really done anything to improve the life of the people here. They've been a little bit kind of slavish mastery kind of vibes. And I wanted to see these houses kind of butt heads, maneuver around each other. I wanted to see like what Leto was going to do, what the Baron Harkonnen was going to do. They're on Arrakis like 3 days, and then they just, half the cast gets killed. Duke Leto was in like 4 scenes. And then there's this other character, Duncan Idaho, who also gets killed off, who was also in like I think Duncan Idaho was in 2 scenes. He has a scene with Paul.
Yeah, he's in the least amount of Paul's friends.
He has a scene with Paul. And then he has a scene where he gets drunk and yells at Jessica, who is Paul's mother. And that's it. And then he dies. And you're supposed to be sad about it. And then there's this other character, Dr. Kynes, who also, you get like 3 scenes. And then he dies. And his death is like pages long. Like pages of him having this whole internal monologue with his father, who's been dead for years. And I'm like, I don't care about you. I liked him as a character, but he did nothing. So why the fuck do I care about this man?
Okay. So I think the problem with the first third of the book.
One more thing. Despite nothing happening in the first third, it's so much pages. It's so many pages. So many.
Yeah, we should say that this book is super long. On Audible, it's 20 hours, and it's a long book. I listened to it at double speed, so it was shorter for me. But so the first third, that's the part of the world that I love most, is the houses and the interplay between them and the politicking. And it helps that the author is really good at writing smart characters countering each other through plots and writing their personalities. And, you know, there's a point where they say plans within plans, wheels within wheels. He's very good at it. And it's really cool to see this neo-feudal setting. That being said, I used to work in a stable, and there was this thing about how if you're going to walk behind a horse, you either need to walk right next to them or far away, because if you walk right next to them and they kick you, it won't build up enough power. And if you walk far away, they won't reach you. And there's this kill zone that you don't want to be in, right in the middle. The plot, to me, the first third feels like that. It's right in that kill zone that's not quite good. If it was shorter, it could push them into, it would make the book shorter as a whole, which would be good, and it would push them into the real plot, which is him with the Fremen. Or if it was like its own book and like just at the very end he escapes, that would be better too, because you would feel like, okay, this is going somewhere. And I think it's just in between. And I think part of the problem is that he does a very good job of setting up the world and the characters. But if he really needed to, he really should have ruthlessly culled some of the characters. Thufir Hawat, their Mentat, doesn't really need to be a character. He says something about the world, but he's not super important. Gurney Halleck even doesn't need to super be a character.
Duncan Idaho and Gurney Halleck could be the same person, which is, I think, what they did in the movie. I'm pretty sure they just took Gurney Halleck.
They're separate characters, but I think they gave more of the stuff to Gurney Halleck to Duncan Idaho.
Oh. They are separate characters then.
Yeah, we'll see how the movie handles it, which we were going to do a podcast on. And there actually has been a movie of it and a sci-fi miniseries, and both of them were terrible, because so much of this book happens in the minds of the characters, and it's how he describes the mental, what they're thinking, how they're moving, what their viewpoint
is. That's why the first third was so long, but nothing happened.
I agree, it's too long. I really like the atmosphere of it. And
I do too!
again, the sort of the, I forget what it's called in actual plot terms, but like the pushing off point for the protagonist, which should happen at 12%, happens at like 30% through the book. And so it's true. I just agree with that pretty much.
Yeah.
One thing you talked about was that you felt like it was like certain missed opportunities, like plot lines you wanted to see go places don't.
Yes. Yes. So like I wanted to see, there's this moment where Duke Leto is looking at some of the customs that the Harkonnens had put in place on Arrakis, and he goes to change them. And I wanted to see, like, he manages to change one before his very quick death. It literally, like, they arrive the next, like, 2 days later, they have a banquet. That night, he's dead. And so there was that. And then also, there was this beautiful tension between Thufir Hawat, who's the Mentat, the Atreides Mentat. So he's that, like, human computer. And then Jessica. And Jessica, again, is the Bene Gesserit witch lady. She's fabulous. I love me, Jessica. I stan.
Can I just say, Jessica is such a great character. And I love that she's not a character you usually get, which is the mother of the protagonist. Like, that's not a character that's ever really focused on. And yeah, she is. She's her whole character. I kind of just like how she recedes into the background in the last third, but we'll talk about that when we get there.
But yeah, and there's this beautiful, like, the Harkonnens create a message to be intercepted by the Atreides that, because there's a spy, there's a double agent. There's a plant, like someone in their house is working for the Harkonnens and is going to bring them
like
downfall.
An orchid.
Yeah. And they know that this person exists, but they don't know who the traitor is. Hawat receives this piece of a message that implies, my cat just came in.
Your cat opened the door and came in.
The cat opened the door. Anyway, and that implies that it's Jessica. And so he takes it to Duke Leto, and Leto knows, like, he 100% trusts Jessica with his life. Again, we stan this relationship because it's actually a really nice one. But he lets Hawat look into Jessica so that the Harkonnens believe what's happening. Jessica begins to realize something's up pretty quickly. And then Duncan Idaho yells at her and basically confesses that Hawat and them think that she's the traitor. And there's this amazing scene. What a tension builder. Just like one of the best scenes in the book between Jessica and Hawat. And so you have these two incredibly smart people who are made to observe and then digest information to draw conclusions from it. And Hawat is convinced Jessica is the traitor, and she's trying to convince him otherwise. And it's just this battle of wills, and it's this beautiful tension. And they kind of leave it where she uses the voice on him and is able to control him. And he's like, oh, fuck, she's way more powerful than I thought she was. And it's this awesome. And I wanted to see that play out. You know, like, he set it up, because it's not like it went anywhere. It was just a setup for a beautiful,
it's like the third scene before shit goes down and the Atreides die.
She has this scene and then goes to bed. A couple, like, you cut to a couple other people, she wakes up, she's captured by the Harkonnens. Like, what? I wanted to see this, you know, like, wow. And then Hawat, who I finally was interested in as a character, poofs into existence. Like, he's just gone as a character, and we don't see him for most of the book.
I actually agree. Because again, it goes back to that, like, what reading at a young age, I expect it to do that. So, like, to me, it's not a problem, but I definitely, that would have been so cool to see keep going. And, you know, there is a tragedy to knowing that Duke is moving into this thing and it's going to blow up on him and he has no choice. But, like, it would have been really cool if that, like, was just a book on its own, that part. Yes. And you don't know what's necessarily going to happen, and then at the end all the shit goes down. Okay, shorter or longer, but not exactly how long it is.
Exactly. And then I have the same issue with Dr. Yui, who is their conditioned doctor, so he should be 100% loyal, but the Harkonnens have found a way to get around his conditioning, which is, you know, torturing his wife. They build up, and because, you know, Yui is the traitor, because each chapter starts with a little quote from Princess Irulan, and so she's like, Yui was the traitor, and then also there's a scene with Baron Harkonnen, and he was like, we got their doctor, I found his weak point. So you know immediately, but they set it up as like this big betrayal. But again, we spend so little time with the character of Dr. Yui, that when it happens, all the characters are aghast and shocked, and I had no emotional response, because it meant, again, I liked these characters. I liked Yui. I liked the conflict he was in, but we just spend so little actual time getting to experience anything with them and develop bonds with them that it literally like...
I totally agree. I could see how that's frustrating. I think part of the problem is there's so much world building that needs to be front and center.
And that's the problem.
That's one of the things I noticed going in is that like basically towards the book, there's a scene where Paul meets, talks to Thufirhawa, he talks to Gurney, he talks to Idaho, he talks
one
to his mom.
One after another. Come into the room.
And like, I understand why, because it's good. You get a grounding of the character and each of them talks about a different aspect of the world. So it doesn't feel like it's an info dump, even though it is.
It is.
But it takes forever. It takes a long time. And, you know, like some cool stuff happens. There's some action the first third. Like there's an assassin thing that goes after Paul and there's some stuff with like one of the sandworms, but it's too long or not long enough.
And one of the things that Will and I had spoken about, because he said, well, you know, it's the before the plot starts. And I said, no. The plot started when they moved to, because his safe, like the previous world that he knew, because in the hero's journey, there's the moving away from the world that you knew. And that's Caladan. And this first third of the book is set up as if it was the getting to know the character, getting to know his life before the hero's journey starts. But that's leaving Caladan. Once they hit Arrakis, like, ta-da. So it just, and it, Will's absolutely right. It needed to be shorter or it needed to be longer. I myself would have loved the longer version. This should have been my favorite part of the book because I was interested in all, and this, it took me a minute, and I'll just say this in general, it took me a minute to get with the writing narration style. It's been a while since I've read something from this era.
Yeah, and also it's third person omniscient, so he'll switch viewpoints in the middle of a scene, which I never found confusing, but you said you did kind of find it confusing.
Yeah, because I'm so not used to it.
Nobody writes that way anymore.
Yeah, nobody writes that way, and so it's been a very long time since I've read something that did that, and it was sometimes hard to track, and especially because I'm listening and the narrator.
Okay, we do need to talk about the audiobook because the audiobook is weird because yeah. It's half like radio play where they have different actors do different voices and then one narrator. It does that half the time and the other half the time it's just one narrator.
I would say a third of the time.
Yeah, and they'll switch over in the middle of scenes. Like the Baron Harkonnen, the main bad guy, has like a very Mufasa voice when there's a voice actor doing it, and then he just has a normal voice when the narrator's doing it, and they'll switch right in the middle of a scene from one voice to the other, and it makes your brain process it differently. Your brain accepts, okay, this is reality when it's just one voice. We know it isn't, but we'll pretend. But that is mismatched with how real it sounds during the audio drama part, which I actually really liked. I like how weird it sounds when there's different voices.
Yeah, there's almost this like echoey nature to it. But the problem was when characters think stuff, their thoughts are never, because even the one narrator will make the voices sound different. But when a character is just thinking and thinks, ah, I've fallen into a trap, it's the narrator's normal narration. So when you're going from like one character's thought about a situation, then there's a sentence, and then all of a sudden you're in another character's thought about what's happening. Like it took me a while. And also he's a little, compared to some of the stuff I've been reading recently, especially initially, a little stuffier, because the last thing I read that was from a similar time period was the Hyperion Cantos, which has a much more casual tone. Like, this guy reminds me, like, if you think of, like, Tolkien has a more, like, legend, telling a legend story tone, and this kind of has that vibe a little bit. I wouldn't say exactly, but it's a little bit more...
It's just a different style, yeah.
Once I got used to it, it was fine, but it did take me a while.
I actually just looked it up really quickly, and Hyperion Cantos was published in 1989. Dune was published in 1965.
Yeah, so that's... Never mind. That's... I will not say from the...
But like, that's one of the things that's interesting about it, is it is such an old book in a lot of ways.
And there's so many things that are, I'd say, quite modern in ideas about it. And again, it's a work that has defined the genre. So of course you're going to find things that happen in modern books.
Yeah, it's a bit like being like, oh, The Godfather is a little archetypal of a mafia story. It's like, yeah, that's what's up.
Yeah, that's
but like, I don't necessarily think it lets the book off the hook, but like, I do think there's a certain amount of that and a certain amount of like, he probably felt like he had to move slow because audiences were not as
used to.
Yeah, as used to these high level ideas.
It feels like a high fantasy sci-fi, because normally you have like hard or soft sci-fi.
I really love the atmosphere of it and the writing of it. It's so great. I mean, I wish I could write that way. It's very like unsentimental and smart, and like you don't feel like it's booky in the way that I dislike certain things.
Like, the narrator has no feelings. Like, the narration itself has no feelings. It's only through characters' thoughts that we get feelings about what's happening. And that's really, like, not something you see a lot. But yeah, so despite me having to get used to that narration style, I was still really interested in all of the things being laid out in the first third. So I was super mad when none of it was all abandoned. And also, I thought Piter was going to be such a terrifying, cool villain. He was a mentat, but he was like a sociopathic mentat. And yeah. I wanted to see him do cool shit. He did. Readers or listeners, he did nothing. He didn't do a single goddamn thing.
I will make a slight defense of the book in that I do think it's interesting, at least conceptually, to have all these people planning things and things and things, you know, all these sandcastles of plans, and then they're just wiped out through chaos. You know what I mean? Like, they're all just cut short because, like, that's just... But I don't think it really works that well, because again, it would work better if it was a longer work or a shorter work.
Because they could have done all the same things if it was shorter.
No, I think it would have actually been more effective. But let's go to part two, which is actually interesting, because this is after Paul and Jessica flee into the desert and they meet up with the Fremen. And this is when Paul really has his awakening of, like, his mental awakening, because he's eating more of the spice, the melange, as they say. And so he sees the future. He's all of a sudden really powerful mentally. And they meet the Fremen and they kind of have to ingratiate themselves into the culture, and the whole thing actually really happens only over like 3 days. It's almost a continuous sequence, but it works really well because this is the part of the book I think is the best and the part that I enjoy the most.
I would agree.
It's really cool to see the Fremen culture, and there's a lot of cool, there's like some action, and the plot is interesting, and I think it really works well.
And you have a lot of really cool scenes. So like the scene when Paul gets his like initial burst of prescience is before he meets the Fremen, and it's this fantastic, like, you get the first glimpses of the jihad, like, because he has these premonitions of the jihad, and he's like, oh no, I don't want that to happen. But it's just him, and then, like, his mother, like, they've just lost Duke Leto, she's full of grief, he can't cry, so it's this beautiful scene kind of leading into this, and you have similar scenes throughout this second part, especially at the end. I'd say the next one that would I think is literally what ends part two is when she becomes the Reverend Mother.
And that's a really cool sequence because...
Oh, it's so good. I would say that's one of the other best parts of the book.
Yeah, because the melange has had such an effect on her that she can actually change her biochemistry to make a poison not a poison and just a harmless liquid. And this is the thing, though. I really like, okay, it starts here and it'll blossom into a real problem in the third for me. And one of the reasons I never read the sequels because it gets even worse. It's almost like a power creep thing, but the human computers, I really like the idea of. They're super disciplined. Even the Bene Gesserit ability to control people sort of through their voice, very cool. When it starts going into like woo-woo magic stuff, it starts to really bother me when it's like, oh, I'm so smart, I can predict things in the future that haven't even happened. Or like, it wasn't telepathy that they were talking about, but their ancestral genes were in sync. And I'm like, that's just magic. That's magic with more steps. And I don't like it as much.
And this starts, and it also connects to something that happens in the first third, which is this idea of Paul as a messiah character. So he's the Kwisatz Haderach.
Yeah, what happens is that the Bene Gesserit have implanted very early in people's cultures, like thousands and thousands of years ago, safety protocols in case a Bene Gesserit gets like lost in that planet, they can fit into a cultural niche in that society. So in this case, they planted one in the Fremen for a, I forget what he's called, basically just a messiah who's going to lead them forward.
Something Gaib. The
Lisan al-Gaib.
The Lisan al-Gaib.
Right. And so they believe that there's a prophet who comes from off-world who will have a Bene Gesserit mother who will be all these things, and they fit in that. So he kind of just fits in right there. I forgot what you were saying.
Oh, so yeah, throughout the first, you start getting hints of this. There's Mapes, who's a Fremen character you meet in the first third, who again dies before doing anything. But anyway, she mentions that like there is a prophecy and you are the one, you are the mother. And then Jessica's like, ah, good, the conditioning we did on these people is working well. I will have a way to infiltrate. And like, she's getting through, like, at one point Mapes asks her a question and she gives an answer. Mapes takes it an entirely different way and is like, you are the one. And like, sheer luck. Whew. But there's this whole like messiah thing. So not only do you have the Bene Gesserit Kwisatz Haderach thing going on, but you have the Lisan al-Gaib thing, and Paul is just both. And like the entire first third, I was like, man, they're really leaning heavily into this messiah thing. In that second like part of the book, that's when it really starts taking off, where people are like, oh, he might be the Lisan al-Ghaib. And he starts realizing that the religious fervor he creates in these people is what's going to cause the jihad. And he's trying to avoid it while also making a place for himself and his mother.
And the thing is that that portion I never got, even as a child, which is like, he's like, oh no, my presence alone will create a jihad. And I'm like, don't buy the ships to go off world. Like, I don't understand the mechanisms of how the jihad is going to happen. Don't super make sense. And so I was always like, or just kill yourself. Like, I don't understand how you can't
live a peaceful life. Like, you have all this like way to like fix the land. Just live a peaceful life. You're not going to see this happen. Just he could have literally, because there's a girl, someone he's been, if you've been watching the ads of the trailers for the movie, that he's been seeing in his visions.
Zendaya, which apparently is a big selling point of the movie that people are freaking out about.
Oh, people, Zendaya's got tons of fans. Between Chalamet and Zendaya, man, it's a
I'm
going to
say this before we watch the movie. I don't think Chalamet is a good casting for this at all. They always make the mistake of making Paul either too bro-y or too sensitive. And he's not really either. And I don't think Chalamet is going to work. But we'll see. Maybe I'll be surprised.
Funnily enough, because I went into this after seeing the trailers, he just was Chalamet. Like, that was my vision of Paul. Like, congratulations, Timothy Chalamet. You've been in my head the entire time. But anyway, and so, like, you do have this, like, everything starts getting real mystical. And as much
I don't like it.
And as much as I really love the sequence when Jessica becomes a Bene Gesserit, or not a Bene Gesserit, a Fremen reverend mother, as much as I love the scene itself, because it's real cool and it has some weird implications for her unborn daughter that nobody knows about, I don't like it. I don't like that you can share consciousness back to like 2,000 years. Like,
it's magic with more steps, and I don't like it. I think he could have just downsized parts of it without really making... So, like, for example, Paul's ability to see the future is super inconsistent and plot relevant. Like, it's kind of irritating. Like, he can see certain things and can't others. I would have liked it better if it was just like... Usually Mentats... The job of a Mentat is take a bunch of information and figure out what it means, combine it. So I would have liked it if suddenly he could take all this information and combine it into a relatively stable future, understanding of the future that would shift, like, based off of his
playing
information.
Playing out a chess match.
Right, and just describe it a little bit less woo-woo magic. And then at times, he also talks about how, like, he can see things that haven't happened. Like, he knows things he's going to say, but I'm like, you don't know this character exists, so how would you know what you're going to say to them? Like, there is a certain amount of magic to it that's just kind of irritating. I just would have preferred if it stayed a little bit more hard magic, hard sci-fi.
I'd kind of had this hope, because the author plays real hard on this Messiah bit in the first half, and so I was like, I knew going in, because of how hard he was, like, he was laying it on thick, that this wasn't going to be like your classic Messiah story. What I had hoped was that Paul was not going to be a Messiah, he was just going to be a character who had to deal with this situation and, you know, with a group of people, like, defeat this thing. So that's how I thought we were going to turn this narrative trope on its head.
I think he was trying to explore what the role of a Messiah is and how you would think about it and try to shape things, but I don't think he did it well. And there's one thing we do need to talk about, which is basically, and I think it's a big theme in the book and it kind of comes into play. So originally, Frank Herbert was a journalist, and the way that Dune started was he wrote an article about sand dunes, literally sand dunes, and he never published it, but it formed the basis of the book. So the book itself is very essentialist, and it's very much about how environments shape people. The Fremen are shaped by their environment. They are insanely obsessed with water and retaining water and the meaning of water. Later on, it's told that the Imperial Sardaukar, who are like the best troops in the galaxy, they're that way because they're shaped by the tough planet that they live on. And so I think there's an extent to which, and this is a little problematic because the Fremen are coded as non-white, even though I think they're technically somewhat white, but they're coded as non-white. And they are really objects to be acted upon by other characters, which is frustrating. They never really have their own role. Even their dream of one day making Arrakis a paradise planet
is
something Kynes put in, right? And then Paul comes in and hijacks their legends. And he's really trying to talk about essentialism. And so there's a certain amount to which you can kind of think of Paul himself as being a product of all the forces on him and not so much an actor in his own right. But I think that breaks down because I think it's not, Paul never really confronts that. That doesn't really exist because he isn't at any point, he's never at one point like, okay, why don't I just kill myself and stop this jihad, and then makes a decision of, you know what? No, I want to live. Or, you know what? I thought about this time I had choice and I don't. Even my death now will lead to the jihad. I think he mentions that at like one point, but I think that's a theme in the book. And I think it works well with like the Fremen and the Sardaukar. I don't think it works as well with Paul.
See, I think Paul is a slightly different commentary. Cause like by the end of the book, Paul has made decisions that you're like, why? What are you doing? You are literally leading down this path of just like, you know, at this point and you've making, and I think it's the idea that like, fuck heroes. Fuck the one savior. It never is going to end well because the savior is always going to end up. And I think you see this in political climates all the time. He's always, and I read something that compared him to the Godfather, Marlon Brando. Yeah, Michael. Yeah. He's Michael. He doesn't want to be like his dad. He doesn't want to do the thing, but then he ends up becoming even more, you know, like, and takes it, like he modernizes it, but also makes it like worse.
I think that actually would have been a really, if that was more, it was explicated more by the plot. I think that would have been really interesting.
I think that's what the second book is supposed, because I read a synopsis of it. I think that was, that's what the second book is supposed. I think this is the beginning. And similar to the first Godfather, this has a similar ending point. Like he finally has taken the mantle. He's done.
Yeah. So we're into part three talk now. Yeah. We're kind of done with part two.
And I think that's the commentary Herbert is making. You can't just have this one person who's going to lead you. That's how you end up with fanatics. And there's this great point where Paul goes, like, where he realized that, oh, what's his name? The Fremen leader. What's his name?
Stilgar.
He realizes that he's lost a friend in Stilgar and he has created a fanatic. He has a believer in him. He no longer has his friend who Stilgar was. And I think that's the commentary of the hero as, like, you always, at some point, if you're just one guy leading, you are a despot.
Yeah, like I think that's really interesting. And you know what? You're right. That does square with what some of the later books are about. I think it's a little again, I think he could have made it like a little bit more explicit a theme, but I think that actually is a really sustainable reading. And just to let readers know, in the last third of the book, the Fremen basically take on the Harkonnens, and basically the entire galaxy comes in to try and stop the Fremen from rising up. And they get beat down because what happens is that the only way space travel is possible is through the Spacing Guild. The only way they're able to see the future well enough is through the melange, through the spice. They kind of do what Paul does, but with like currents through space. And so Paul is basically like, look, you guys let me be emperor or I'll wipe out the spice. I don't give a shit. Like, I'll do that. And so that's how he gets to be emperor in the end.
Which had never been the goal. Like at no point in the book. Has that ever? There was literally a part where he's like, I don't want to marry Princess Mom. I just want to be happy with Chaney. And then his mom, at a certain point, like there's this huge thing with Gurney Halleck coming back, and she's like, forget what I said, Paul. Be happy, live a quiet life, marry Chaney. I've made a lot of mistakes in my life. And I'm like, yeah, Jessica. Because the entire time you're like, is Jessica going to be the one that pushes him to become the jihad? Because you get that feeling in the kind of in the first third, a little bit in the second third.
She's very shrewd. She very much wants what's best for her son. And so, yeah, she kind of pushes him into different roles at times.
Yeah. And but then she kind of. In the last third, she's actively like, no, 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 do not inspire religious fervor, Paul. Like, what you doing, son? Stop it. And then she, because the entire, like, most of the time that she knows Chaney, even after Chaney has given birth to Leto 2, their son, she's still like, you know, like, I love.
Is that a cat?
That is a cat. She's like, I love Chaney, but, you know, Paul needs to do what's best for, like, a royal line. And then, like I said, this thing happens with Gurney Halleck, and she's like, no, 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 forget it all. Be happy. And I'm like, good, I feel like that's. What, like, Paul, this whole time, Paul's been like, how do I avoid the jihad? Congrats, Paul. Live a life with your, like, son and be happy. Like, put all this in. And then he's like, nope, we have to do this thing. We have to revenge Harkonnens. And then all of a sudden, in the end, he goes, like, and the book literally, they say he was in some type of mindset. There was a term they use, and I can't remember it. And they're like, and now he wants to be emperor. Like,
I actually think, you know what it is? And I thought about this as I was going, because there's a scene I had completely forgotten about, which is, and this will loop back, but basically there's a scene right after him and Jessica are running and they meet Leah Kynes, and the Atreides are losing, but they haven't totally lost yet. And he hatches his plan. He's like, look, I'll make this plan. I will blackmail the emperor into letting me marry his daughter so that he doesn't know, so that the galaxy at large doesn't know that he wiped out a royal house, which is what they fear more than anything. As I was reading, I was like, dude, like, just run away. Like, why is this your plan to get out of this problem? And it's because at his heart, I think Paul is an aristocrat. And so he is not really able to think outside the mindset of aristocratic power. And I just wish someone had commented on that, like, you know, a normal person would just go into the desert and live quietly, but he can't because he himself was shaped by his environment, just as the Fremen were, just as the Sardaukar, just as the Bene Gesserit are trying to create something. So I think that would have been, it would have fixed a plot hole in a way of like, this is just his character of like, he can't not be an Atreides.
Yeah, like he has to be playing the Game of Thrones.
Yeah, he can't be anything other than what he is. And then also I think it would have been interesting to see in the last third it to be talked about how, like, as much as he shaped the Fremen, they actually then shaped him. So he can't not believe in trying to do this paradise planet. He can't not do all the things he has to do in a big political way. That's maybe a little problematic in that it's like, okay, the Arab-esque characters made the white character more bloodthirsty and savage or whatever. But I think thematically it would have made more sense of like, okay, you can't just change a culture. The culture also changes you.
You, yeah. And I think one of the ways the book lost it a little bit with that, from like that point in the beginning, because you're right, I remember that scene now, is they made it seem like Jessica was the one who couldn't turn the aristocrat off, and that Paul was able to like more easily integrate. And I think you're right. I think if they had made that a little bit clearer the whole time, because even at one point Paul's like, what is my mother pushing me into? And this is like when they first meet the Fremen, like, what is she scheming? And so the entire time, again, you think Jessica's the one that's gonna push him to create the jihad. Meanwhile, my girl Jessica is just being a really fantastic mama bear, and she ultimately just wants her boy to be happy. And Paul,
you almost get out of his mind. Like, I almost think it would have been interesting not to go into his point of view in the last third of the book.
I think that would have been perfect.
Then he becomes somewhat inexplicable and distant and prophet-like, and you would have some of these decisions. You're like, okay, I don't know who he is anymore, and I'm not sure why he's doing these things. Instead of being in his head and being like, dude, why are you not thinking about why you're doing what you're doing? But I think, I'm not sure how much Frank Herbert was, the author, was aware of these things we're talking about. Him being changed by a culture, how much of a problem is that he's an aristocrat versus just going into the desert. I'm not sure how aware he was of them, so I'm not sure how aware he was able to comment on those in the book.
This all connects to why it was difficult for me to finish. Like, it has taken me 2.5 days to read the last, or listen to the last 45 minutes of the book. We were originally supposed to do this podcast last night. I had stuff to do. And so I was like, great, I'll finish it later. I don't have to, because I realized, oh my God, Paul's going to do a no-no. And he does. And so the entire time I'm just like, I don't want to read it. Cause like,
it's not even necessarily that he goes bad. It's that he goes bad and it's not really understandable why.
I mean, he does a bad.
Yes, he does a bad. Yes.
He does a bad. He doesn't go bad. Like I said, we're at the beginning of the journey. We're like end of Godfather 1. Godfather 2 is when we start going real downhill. But he starts making decisions that I'm like, and also cause like the entire time he wants to marry Chaney. And then all of a sudden he's like, I shall marry Princess Irulan. And like Will said, there is a tiny little baby scene all the way back in the first third that kind of connects to that, but like it feels like it comes a little bit out of left field. And and then like there's this thing where like Gurney Halleck has been on this quest for revenge.
Gurney Halleck is like one of their house soldiers.
Yeah, and there's this point where he's separated and then he comes back, and again it would have been more impactful and emotionally satisfying if I cared about Gurney on a deep level. But again, he was in two scenes prior to him disappearing for a huge chunk of the book. Paul has promised him his Harkonnen kill, and at this point, Baron Harkonnen is dead. Oh, also, we have to talk about the creepy things in this book, which we'll get to. There's two things that are weird. But anyway, and he's like, Baron Harkonnen is dead, and so it's the Na Baron, who is Fade Ratha.
Played by Sting in the original movie, by the way. That movie is super weird.
So Gurney's like ready to kill the Na Baron, and then the Na Baron's like, I challenge Paul, and everybody's like, Paul, don't do this. You don't have to do this. Like Chaney, Jessica, and Gurney are all like, nah, bro. Nah, don't do this. We don't do this. And Gurney's also like, let me have my kill, bro. Like, you promised me my revenge. And he's like, nah, Gurney, step back, man. Let me. And I'm like, like, fuck you, Paul. Like, this man's your friend. Like, what are you doing? You're going to get what, and the thing is, you're going to get what you want. You know, like, you're going to, at this point in the book, you know what's happening. There's no surprises from this point on.
That was also one of the problems, is that I don't feel like the vengeance part of the book in the last third is as satisfying as it could be, because, like, so the Baron Harkonnen is killed by Jessica's daughter, who is creepy witch lady, but, like, it almost happens, not off screen, but it's really perfunctory, and he never confronts Paul.
Not lady. She's a two-year-old.
Yes. She's a two-year-old who was born with all of the knowledge of her mother and generations of reverend mothers. Because, again, woo-woo mind magic.
During the scene where Jessica became a reverend mother, she was pregnant with Aaliyah. And so Aaliyah's conscious also got all of this information. So she's like, she's a two-year-old. And I really wish Herbert would have made her at least six. Because there are levels, even because her mind is super developed, but they even say she has the lisp of a soft palate because her palate hasn't fully, like, developed yet. But then they also talk about her stabbing people and, like, marking bodies for, like, bitch, she doesn't have that. Like, she doesn't have
the motor skills.
Like, 2-year-olds don't move that good. You know, like, they're wobbly. And so it's just really weird. And she, the 2-year-old, is the one who kills Baron Harkonnen in the most, like Will said, anticlimactic way. She pretends to be scared. He grabs her as if he's going to kill her. And then she ganja bars him. And the ganja bar is,
it's like a poison.
A needle.
I disliked that, and I've always disliked that. And then also, like, I wanted a big battle scene, and it kind of happens off screen a little bit.
It does happen off screen. It literally happens off screen.
Yeah, it was not as satisfying as it could have been.
Yeah, they're in a ship, and Aaliyah's like, my brother's coming. And the Emperor's like, nah, let's leave, guys. We're going to go. And then the most you get of the battle is suddenly there is a sea of sandworms coming in with Fremen on their back. And that's, like, congratulations. And then, like, Paul comes in and he's like, I did it. Like,
I just would have liked it to be a little bit more satisfying. And honestly, I actually really love the Baron Harkonnen as a villain. Like, he's one of my favorite villains. He's so smart. I mean, it's kind of offensive that he's a fat gay guy and super evil, but, like, he is a great villain. And, like, they also talk about how fat he is a lot. And I'm like, all right, like, calm. I understand it's the 60s, but calm down, okay?
If you take away the, like, weird gay stuff, and besides that, I completely agree. I love him as a villain, and he's like, he's just smart, and he's got
he's intelligent
plans, and he's craft, like, I respect that villain of a man, you know. And then also, he kind of got dumb in the last third.
It does seem like he got dumb. It does. You're right.
Like, he knows nothing.
I think partly you can think of it as that Thufir Hawat, because Thufir Hawat goes to work for the Baron Harkonnen afterwards because he's a mentat. He just doesn't know how not to serve. But, like, you can kind of think of it as maybe he was kind of screwing with the Harkonnens a little bit and giving them bad advice. And so they were making the Fremen stronger without realizing it. But that needed to be said if that was the case. And also, there's no real plot twist to the ending. That's the other thing, is, like, there's no real reversals of, like, okay, maybe it's going to be tough and then maybe it isn't. And then they come in with the thing. It's like the Fremen just ride in and beat everybody.
Also, there was, like, this huge, like, surprise at the end of the first third, like, when Paul has his prescience moment and he realizes he's the grandson of the Baron Harkonnen and Jessica is his daughter. And that had absolutely zero impact. The only people who had impact were Paul and Jessica, who were like, oh my god. But there literally is a scene where Aaliyah, like, during the scene where she kills him, she's like, haha, grandfather, I've killed you. And, like, no reactions.
Nobody,
like,
knows
no
what's
one,
up.
The Emperor, like, no reactions. And then the only reaction you ever get is the Reverend Mother being like, oh, Jessica figured it out. And that's it.
Okay, so do you want me to tell you about some of the later books then? Okay, so I have never read the sequels because they go, I know what happens in them. I've read, like, the summaries, because they go even more into the woo-woo weird magic stuff. So first of all, Duncan Idaho comes back as a clone.
Yes.
Right? Aaliyah has a thing for him, but she gets possessed by the genetic ghost of the Baron Harkonnen.
What?
Yes. Paul has twins, but goes blind, so he goes back out into the desert, because that's the Fremen way. His twins are then, at some point, have to come back and are almost killed by Aaliyah, but then they grow up, and then they come back, and they defeat Aaliyah, who is, again, possessed by the... And what happens is that there's a male and a female twin, right? The male twin becomes a sandworm, and the Atreides line continues through the female sister. He becomes an eternal emperor. And so Duncan Idaho continually comes back each generation trying to kill him, the Atreides line, because he has become a god emperor in a real right.
As a sandworm.
As a sandworm. And you can look up some of the art. It's super disturbing because he's like half sandworm, half person. A lot of times it's like a sandworm with a human face.
Oh, that's really
if it's not just like a mermaid sandworm.
I don't like it.
Right. And what happens is that they all become subsumed. He becomes a god emperor. He rules over everybody because he can see the future. There is almost no human individuality left. He sees this as a problem. Sandworm Leto sees this as a problem for whatever reason.
Ooh.
And looking it up. Yeah, it's again, it gets super weird.
I don't like it.
So basically, he starts trying to cultivate a gene in humans that makes it so that they can't be seen in the future. It's a gene that prevents his omniscient sight from seeing them, which is even more woo-woo magic than anything else, because it doesn't make any sense how a gene would do that. And eventually, he is able to get Duncan Idaho to kill him, and then the humans go out into diaspora. And then they come back and some other dumb stuff happens because he died at that point and his son finished the books and his son is even worse of a writer than him. But yeah, that's the reason I've never read them, because they just become increasingly dependent on this like magic prescience stuff, which is my least favorite part of the book.
So I read some of this, like, because I read a synopsis. I read what happened to Paul's character and then like saw that his son, like it said, Leto begins the transformation into sandworm. And I went, what? See, that he becomes like Emperor Leto Sandworm was weird, because initially I just read he became a sandworm. And then I thought he makes this spiritual transformation and just goes into the desert and lives as a mindless, like he lets go of human consciousness. Mm-hmm. And just, that's how I, reading this very short summary, took that. And now you have made it
a half sandworm.
You have made it even worse. Like, that is super duper gross. And like, and then like, there's also apparently a point, and I don't know if you are familiar with this, where Paul comes back as a clone with Chaney, and then he's like, I've loved you for 5 seconds. Like,
so this is even dumber.
What is up with all these clones?
Basically, yeah, that happens later when his son starts writing the books.
So I will probably not read the rest.
That's Dune. It's a book I love and a book I find problematic and a series I hate in like a weird way. But, you know, I do love it because it is one of the foundational works. And I do think it does a lot of stuff very well. And I think he's a very good writer.
Some beautiful sequences. Beautiful sequences that as I'd read them would almost make me forget during those sequences the things I had deep issue with. So, good writer. I think I'll probably read the other two. Not now.
If you want to read the other two, I'm down. I'll read them with you.
I want to, just because I want to experience this. And also because it's one of those book series similar to like Tolkien's where there's like scholars that like study. Because I read this book and I went, I don't see what you would build an academic career out of with these. But it's there. Like, this is a thing that exists. And I was reading some comments because Amanda the Jedi made a review about the movie, which is, you know, the first half of the book. She talks about the Messiah a bit, and everybody in the comments were like, ho, 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 wait till you see how he turns the Messiah trope on its head. Mo-ho-ho. And that for me was confirmation of, again, what my prediction was that he just wasn't going to be the Messiah. And it was going to be like completely turning it on. And like, there is no Messiah. There is no savior. Save yourselves, motherfuckers. And so like, I took that as confirmation, but like people were like, ma-ha-ha, wait till you see how it's subverted. And I got to it and I was like,
I mean, I think the subversion is that he's not a good Messiah.
Yes,
like,
and that's
things he's a Messiah of is not good.
And again, I think it's commentary to like,
no, you're entirely right.
A lot of cultural revolutionists.
Because what you were saying, like, again, now that I explained the later books, that's the problem, is that he is one person who has grown too strong and he's crippling humanity's ability to evolve and be individual people, and that's what he tries to destroy. So yeah, I actually would be down with reading the sequels if you want to.
Yeah,
maybe they're not
I'd
as bad
to.
As I think, you know?
I think the benefit, like you said, is Herbert's a good writer, and he obviously, this is laying the ground, like, I think he had plot planned out. The entire time I was reading this book, I was like, this man knows where he's going.
Yeah, there's an assuredness to
it. He's just taken some weird ways to get there. And so I feel like there would be at least the benefit of, because you know sometimes you read a book series and you're like, I'm pretty sure the author is writing this as it's being popped into their mind and they have no idea where this is going to end up. J.K. Rowling in the Harry Potter series.
The Game of Thrones TV series.
Yeah.
So, but that's for a whole nother podcast. Anyway, let's finish up this one. Dune, what were your final thoughts? Because I actually am really curious. in terms of like your overall good, bad, worth reading?
Worth reading. I mean, it's a cultural phenomenon that defined a genre that I love. So absolutely. I mean, you can even find influences, though actually I think I can find more connection between Ursula K. Le Guin and Hyperion, but there's even like in the Hyperion series, some elements of like this, especially with the idea that like planets define the people on them and like all that stuff. And so for that, absolutely. And for the sequences that really were beautiful and he did a great job with, and overall, like I liked the overall plot. I might not have liked how we got there, and I don't like the woo stuff that happened, but unlike you, I think I'm more prone to be okay with it. I just don't love how he did it. I think it was a little too heavy-handed.
You know what's interesting is this is my natural like super high standards conflicting with my I read it when I was youngness, so like I'm both super critical and super like it, and the two are sort of marrying in a weird way right now.
No, this is, it's a little bit how I felt with when we were doing Spinning Silver, because like there are like Spinning Silver is a slow book.
That's exactly what I was thinking. Is I'm kind of like Maria with Spinning Silver, where like I can see the problems, but like they don't super bother me.
Yeah, like I love it despite it, you know, like, and for me also with that Spinning Silver, I actually like the slow pace of it, and I like the different character point of views, but I can see absolutely why it's issues for other people. So that's how I felt like we were going into your potential. Though I have to say it would be a little bit different because you read this when you were younger. I read Spinning Silver like 2 years ago. You know, like it's not like I had this deep bond with it.
No, that totally makes sense.
I mean, it was really interesting. I thought we were gonna butt heads more.
Yeah, I thought so too, but now I agree with that's the thing is like I'm hypercritical even of stuff I really love. Mm-hmm. And I think, you know, again, I think you're right. Now having read it again, make it two books. Make it two books. It would have been a lot better. Downsize the woo-woo-ness a little bit. Acknowledge some of Paul's weird behavior in the second half as being... Give reasons for it. I think it could be a really... I think it could have been much better. So that's it. And thanks for listening, guys. We're going to be doing... Next week, we're going to be releasing the movie version where Katie will be back. She didn't read this one, so it'll be interesting to get her perspective on it. I am really scared about the movie because I don't think it's going to be good, because I think it's so hard to translate some of this, the mental, like it really uses the medium of a book to explore these ideas. And I don't think a movie can't explore those, but I think it would have to change the plot a lot and the sequences a lot.
I'm wary. Plot will benefit. I think the political side of things, and true. I think the actual plot, what happens will benefit. Because I said to Will earlier today, I think I'm going to like the movie overall better, because I think, again, for me, we spent a lot of time in people's heads that I did, especially in the first third, that I did not think was necessary. And I think you're going to lose a lot of that. And I think what that's going to make room for is developing relationships with the characters that makes the things that happen to them meaningful.
Yeah, well, one thing I've noticed is that the trailers keep pushing Duncan Idaho, and I think it's because he dies at the end. So they're like, okay, he can be more of a character in this one so that his death means more. And like,
but he dies in the beginning.
Okay, so it seems like the movie is splitting more or less where I think it should, which is more or less right after they meet up with the Fremen.
Oh, yes. So you're right, he does
and
die.
I've always thought the movie should be split up into those two. We probably will not get a second movie because Denis Villeneuve, he makes beautiful sci-fi movies, but they tend to be kind of slow, and they also are expensive and don't get money, like Blade Runner 2049.
I love that.
Yeah, it was funny. I'm still salty about Ana de Armas dying in that movie, and I will never not be salty about it. And one day I'm going to make a video on how it's kind of indicative of all the problems with the movie. All right. Thanks for listening, guys. Tune in next week.
Bye.